Okay, I will talk about test automation for regression and application testing with robot framework. So I'm Mika Karalo from Valmet, and I will first tell a little bit why to use automated testing, so motivation for a little bit, then about the robot framework, some principles and basics, and then what we have used there is the OPC UA, the free OPC UA, it's the Python library, and then the write for the robot framework interactive the design editor. And then some use cases, how we can use the robot framework for unit and regression testing, a little bit about the Jenkins, how you can integrate with for build and test automation. And then I will have a short demonstration and summary. So motivation, how to test large software that is not totally in your hands. So that's the case when you are using some framework behind the, your own application when you are building, a, for example, the OPC UA server or client. So what happens if you change the framework version? So what you have to do for your software? And if you are refactoring the code asset, what happens then? Will it work the same way? So these are the quite common cases when you are building a large software. And if you are improving software, will it come slower or will it actually function anymore in the same way as the earlier version? And this is the quite normal case. If you want to run manual tests, 100 steps, do you have a people who can repeat it every day 5 times? You are making new build and then it should be retested again and again and again. So it's useless to make it manually. So this is the motivation why I'm introducing this robot framework. Who is actually using the robot framework in testing? Nobody? Strange. One, two. Okay. At least somebody knows how to do the testing. So the robot framework is actually coming from Nokia. Do you know Pekka Clark? Perhaps the name of the person, yes. So he has been actually making the Master of Science work when he was working for Nokia, and they actually implemented this robot framework for the Nokia. So Nokia has been using this very largely. And the framework is also extended all the time, so it has own built-in functionality, libraries that you can use, there are the, for the MQTT library, there are some other built-in functions like collections and other that kind of utility libraries that you can use when you are implementing your own test cases. But it's open source and free to use. And then there are a lot of those companies, subcontractors, they can actually help you when you are actually implementing a large test asset. They can explain you how to build the test automation, how to build the different kind of resources, test libraries, and so you have actually then the very nice way to automate the test cases. And the architecture is actually so that you have the test data, you have the syntax, you have that robot framework there, and then you have these test libraries. For example, I have implemented some of our own test libraries that will actually bind our communication library into robot framework. Then you have different kind of test tools. You have that write that can you actually edit the test cases, build the test cases, and then you have the, here under the system under test. For in our case, we have been using the Valmet DNA and then this Node OPC UA library, and we have been implementing the server and client. So, and how you can then actually extend this, your robot framework. So we have actually implemented this DNA communication. So we have actually existing DNA communication as a DLL library. In Linux, we can use actually the, in the same way, the dynamic library that can be used in Linux environment operating system. And for the OPC UA communication, we have been using this free OPC UA. So it's available from the GitHub. And then we have been actually defining our own resource files for the DNA and also for the OPC UA. So this actually makes an, a little bit abstraction for the functionality that we have actually in the test library. So these are actually more about the user text, how you are actually defining the test case, what you want to read and what you want to write. You are not using the those low-level functions. Instead, I have the demo that will explain it better, but you can actually read dimensions or read size. You are not reading some specific variable or item directly. You are using more abstract terms when you are writing these test cases. It's more about the language that you are actually normally using and talking with your friends and making those test cases. So it hides this actual complexity that is there behind the communication. So in our use cases, we have been using these basic unit test cases for the type conversions between the DNA types and with the OPC UA types. And then we have been using this also to make the quality mapping between the DNA fault bits and the OPC UA quality. And then we have the different kind of table access cases, because we have those one-dimensional tables, two-dimensional tables, and three-dimensional tables. And then for the event testing, we have been implementing different kind of the, because we are actually trying to sync the DNA alarm to OPC UA alarms and events. And then we have those cases for the limit alarms and the discrete alarms. So this perhaps tells a little bit more. So we have the DNA alarms coming, and then we can use the OPC UA events. So you have here the alarm hierarchy, for example. You have our alarm station, alarm server, and then you can have hierarchical different kind of process areas or alarm areas that are actually giving those alarms. I don't think, have you seen this kind of implementation, Jouni, that you can actually split the alarms to different hierarchies? It is used somewhere in some systems, but I actually just used, because it was available, and I actually exposed that to OPC UA alarms as own hierarchies. Do you have any comments, Jouni?
Yeah, I think that is kind of the idea. I haven't seen those done much, but the idea is that you can have a separate alarm hierarchy and then a communication hierarchy.
Yeah, because then you can actually subscribe to a specific alarm area. If you are not interested in all the alarms that are coming from the system, you can select just a specific alarm area, for example, the wet end, or with the power plant, you can actually take turbine hall alarms, not all the alarms from the system. And then we have there the standard priorities and what is the server and the source name message, and then there is the event type and this if the alarm is active or not. But those are standard fields what are defined in the OPC UA. So next is the demo. I have a backup slides then if it's not working, but I will show the ride first and then the OPC UA expert. Let's see. Okay. So this is the ride now. So I have here the own folder that contains the OPC UA robot. This is the system under test. Then I have selected from here the some of the test cases. So this is just defining the other test cases that the write will show in this format. And if you look the text format, it's the plain text or this more table-like test cases. And then we have here the resources. Those are actually then defined how to read the size. And this is actually just hiding the complexity again. It's just giving the nice way how to explain what it should do. So if I go here are the importing those test libraries, some resources and some variables. But I can start the tests directly from here. So now it's running the test. The first test was passing. Now it should run in the test ANA. The second test, it was passing. And the third one is the int S. Those are basic DNA types that are used in the communication. So it's then running those tests. It's actually reading the information from, or writing the DNA and reading the from OPC UA server the data. Then it's writing through the OPC UA to DNA, and then again reading from the DNA. So it's testing the communication both ways. So it should be always the values the same when it's writing from the DNA to OPC or from the OPC UA back to DNA. So it's the kind of round trip testing. And then we can actually see very nicely these reports. So this is how it has been running the test. So you can actually use also different tags in the test. No, it was just the basic tests. So it shows how long it is testing, start times, end time. And if we go back to write, there is also the log that you can actually look more details also what it has been doing. So it will actually put here all those, what it's doing, how long it takes time. So you get a very detailed log report when you are using this robot framework. It's automatically generating these. Do you have any questions at the moment from this one? Not yet. Back to OPC UA expert then. So I have here now the, I have connected this DNA node OPC UA server. Then I have here the objects. Under objects I have these alarms, and there is the our alarm node, and then I have this alarm hierarchy. So there are the different kind of alarms now coming here. And then I have also the DNA namespace or folder. There is the process station, and the process station now I have just the PR, the process data. There is also coming if I put all those diagnostics and system names and those logics in interface address space. I have a little bit limited address space in this test environment. But then you will have access to all those DNA folders and variables. So it's a little bit bigger than, I think this was some 2,000 or 5,000 names that are actually now under this one OPC UA server. And then I have here the event view, so I can actually just look these events, what has been, what was coming here when I started the system. So I think here are some, yeah. There comes the acknowledge or disturbance, and those severity are coming there. And, so I have different kind, with different kind of severity, the different kind of alarms from the simulation system that I have been running here. And those alarm objects are also instantiated here. So you can actually see all those. And the message is the same message that we are actually generating with the DNA. And then I have still the server diagnostics view, so I can actually look these. What are the parameters here, what is the build information, and the current time is running all the time. So the server is alive, state is running. But this is just one manual way to check how the server is running. Okay, back to this and continue the presentation. So this was also backup slides if the demo was not working. So I have here the a little bit debug or this write output taken into here that, but I was just running the selected test cases. And so if you integrate this, if you are actually automated also the software that you can use the Jenkins, you can actually use those free OPC UA, the command line commands. I didn't take examples now here, but you can use those with the Jenkins. So when you are building the software, you are building the installation package, and if you automate also the deployment, that you can actually put the Jenkins to deploy that installation package to some virtual machine, then you can actually start the server, and then you can use the command line commands that will actually validate that the server is installed, and then it's running. You can list the address space, for example. This is how we have making the Jenkins integration. So when you have all the software build functionality in place, then you can validate immediately if the software package is also correct. So the build has been complete. So here was the test report and the test log. And then was this address space. So these are available then with the presentation that I will give to Jouni. I didn't yet copy that to you. And then there was also one slide that I have we have integrated this diagnostics to Valmet DNA. So we have this DNA user interface, and we can actually then take this also into our standard user interface that the end user can check without the UA expert what is the server state, is it running or not, what is the current time, what was the start time, and it will show also this cumulated session count and current session count. So there is all this now available also with the DNA diagnostics. Then, as a summary, it's good to automate your software production process. So it's the Jenkins can be used to build package and automate these tests. And then we have been implementing first these basic tests and some simple tests. Now we have some advanced tests that will actually also test those events. And then we have some test cases now how we can stress and benchmark our OPC UA server and also the client. And the other benefits what we have had, the interoperability, because now we are using actually, I have also the CSAR programs that can access our server. We have the Prosys Java client that we can use, and then this Python client that can be used to in the test cases to test the OPC UA server. And so this test asset is actually coming as important as your software asset, because with that test asset you can always validate that your software is built correctly, it runs correctly, it still has the same features that it has earlier version. So, some questions and discussion.
Yeah, thank you, Mika.
I'm not very familiar with testing platforms or test robots, but can it be used also to test an application that has a graphical user interface where you can enter data as if it were like users entering?
Yes, I know that there are existing, for example, the Selenium is that provides for the web user interface if you are using web browser. Then you can use that to automate and integrate. I think the Nokia has used that quite a lot. So there are actually a lot of those discussions how to use which version of the Selenium you should use if you are making this kind of web-based user interface, and then you can actually automate all those basic click-clack entry, check what happens, and yeah.
Okay, interesting. Thank you.
More questions? So Mika, what is the status of Valmet DNA OPC UA server at the moment?
We are still testing, as I said, there are some refactoring done in some software components, and it's not always the positive development, so I have to refactor my code and make some changes, and there are some messages has been changed, and so lot of work still to do. Even I have those diagnostics implemented, the packaging implemented, and I have almost everything ready, but still we know that some of those regression test cases are now failing, and we have to fix those before we can release the product for the pilot projects. So I hope we will get it done in 1 month or 2 months, but at least end of this year. So if you are interested, if you are our customers that you have the Valmet DNA, we could discuss some small scale pilot testing first. Not immediately the full scale, because I still believe that even we have a lot of test cases, there are still work to do.
Yeah. Only the features that are tested are going to work.
What?
Only the features that are tested are going to work.
Yeah, but there are still work with the events. It was actually more problematic to synchronize the states between the our system and the OPC UA events. It's not so straightforward that I was thinking about. That's actually the case what we are still working. All those basic stuff and Scalar, Staples, they are, for me, they are clear to fix, or if there is some indexing problems, that is just normal work, but with the alarm states, there is the branching, and if we want to self the states, and if you have been looking about the OPC UA events and alarm specification, it's not so simple. It's a little bit more complicated.
Yeah, it provides all the options, but you have to implement still.
Yeah, and understand actually how the state is changed.
Okay, if no more questions, then we'll have a small break. Okay.
Do you have any tips on parallelizing those tests, because I assume most of them set up the server, do some tests, then maybe shut down the server, so that each test has like fresh server. So it, in my opinion, those kind of things usually take quite long. So do you have any tips on that?
Not at the moment. I think we could actually split the tests so that we are running the basics test as a own feature set, but when we are going those events, we actually need the address place functioning and all those basic functionality before we can test the events. And that actually makes the test environment quite complicated, because then we have to actually know the DNA event state and also the OPC UA event state, and checking that, it's actually a little bit more painful that I was thinking about. But making the parallel testing, I think those stress and benchmarking tests, we actually should now make somehow parallel, because if we are running those at last, then it's taking a really lot of time. And that should be perhaps if it's, we have now actually Jenkins to the pipeline so that if those basic tests are not going through, it will not start the stress testing and it actually stops the production line immediately if it fails in some early phase. So it's the, I know the problem and it's existing. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, then thanks once more.